In this video, we show how to approximate pi by generating random points. We'll start with a quick discussion of the mathematical idea behind the approximation. Then we'll cover the code that it takes to produce an approximation with a large number of points. And finally, we'll cover the code that it takes to produce the animation we're watching right now, where we can see random points being generated and the approximation of pi being updated in the upper right corner with each new point. So the math idea behind this approximation is fairly simple. We take a square of side length 2, and that square is centered at the origin, and we inscribe a circle of radius 1 into this thing. And of course, the area of the square is going to be 2 times 2, or 4, and the area of the circle is pi r squared, or pi times 1 squared, or simply pi. This means the ratio of the areas between the circle and the square is pi over 4. And then the idea is that we generate random points inside the square, and we expect the percent of points inside the circle to be equal to pi over 4, since it's taking up that percentage of the area. So we're going to use a computer to generate many random points. In this picture, it's 20,000 of them. And we calculate the percent of points in the circle. That should be pi over 4. So if we multiply that percent by 4, we should get pi. So pi is approximately equal to 4 times the percent of points in the circle. So the mathematical idea is simple enough. Now we're going to look at the code it takes to get this done. In this video, I'm using a rather arcane computer algebra system called wxMaxima. It's not that popular, but it's open source and it's actively maintained, and I'll post a link to the download page in the description. If you're using a different piece of software, you can just view this as pseudocode, and I'll make sure to cover all the key concepts you need to write your own code. So just to go over what's going on with my code here, I started with the statement kill all, which is just a way of unassigning all the variable assignments so you can start over, and that's useful as you're troubleshooting your code. Anything that starts with a slash star and ends with a star slash is just commented out. Those are just notes to myself as I was building the code. And then we get to the real meat of the thing, where as you can see in the comment, what I'm doing is building a for loop where I generate a random point, I test to see whether or not it's inside the circle, and then we increment a counter if the test is passed. So if a point is inside the circle, the counter should increase by 1. And then we're going to compute the percentage of points that landed inside the circle, multiply by 4, and we'll have an approximation of pi. So I'm starting by setting the counter to 0. I also want to build a list of all the points that have been generated because I want to make a picture of this in a later step. And that's called point list, and it has to start as an empty list. I'm going to use 20,000 points in this particular approximation of pi. And then we get to our for loop. So for n from 1 through m, where m is 20,000, do all this stuff. So we're going to get a random x coordinate. And the way Maxima computes random numbers, if I put in random 2.0, it's going to give me a random decimal number between 0 and 2. So if I take negative 1 plus that, it's going to give me a random number between negative 1 and 1. Same for the y-coordinate, and then the distance to the origin. If that distance is less than 1, we're inside the circle. So then we use an if-then statement to test whether or not that distance is less than 1. In fact, I put in less than or equal to, so any points that land on the actual circle are going to count as being inside the circle. So if distance is less than or equal to 1, then counter needs to be assigned to counter plus 1. In other words, we added 1 to our count of how many points landed inside the circle. Next, we build a list of points so we can display everything in an image later on. So point list, we're going to use the append command, meaning we're adding something to a list. Add to point list the random point that was just generated at each step, and that's going to build that list of 20,000 points. And in this particular section, I want to end by having the program display the approximation of pi at the end. So the approximation, I said, is float. In other words, a floating decimal. I want it to give me a decimal approximation. Float 4 times counter, that's the number of points inside the circle, divided by m, that's the total number of points. So again, 4 times the percentage of points landing in the circle should give me an approximation of pi. And then I said if n is equal to m, in other words, when we get to our 20,000th iteration of this loop, when n is equal to 20,000, then print the approximation of pi. Now, this was a little bit tricky. I had to use the concat command in Maxima in order to take this variable called approximation, the approximation of pi, and turn it basically into text so that it would work inside the print commands. So that's how you use concat. So then I'm going to hit shift enter, and I should get my pi approximation. And our little program spits out approximate value of pi, 3.1406. And you may recall the first few decimals of pi is 3.14159. So we've missed in the thousandths place. That's not bad. Now I want to follow up by making a picture of what we've just done. So I've written wx plot size is 1000 by 1000 pixels. It's important to have a square aspect ratio. Otherwise your circle will come out looking like an ellipse. And wx draw 2D is the command that we're going to use to make the picture. I set nticks to 1000. And that's actually to smooth out the picture of the circle. It's going to use 1,000 points to connect them all with line segments so it looks totally smooth. X range and Y range set to negative 1.3 to 1.3 to give us plenty of margin of error around this circle of radius 1. X ticks and Y ticks false. That just prevents the axes from being labeled and having the labels interfere with the niceness of the picture. You can see I set some stylistic things here for the points, so the color, the type, and the size. And then we're going to plot points, and they're coming from point list. That's the list that we filled during our for loop up here. So point list was filled with 20,000 points. And we're going to plot all of those. And then I need a label for my approximation of pi, so that's what's going on at this next step. I have label. Again, there's the concat command, because I need to turn these variable expressions like m, an approximation that you see in green. I need to turn those into text so that they pop out correctly with the label command. So this is going to say n is equal to whatever the value of m was, which for us was 20,000. And then approximation of pi will be equal to whatever the approximation was calculated to be. And then these two numbers are the coordinates where we place the label. Finally, I have the picture of the circle and the square. I did these last because if I do them first, they get obliterated by all the points. So we got the color, the line width. This parametric curve is the circle of radius 1. So it has an x coordinate of cosine t, y coordinate of sine t. And then we have to say transparent equals true before we plot our square. Otherwise, it's going to fill in with a default color. And then to get the square plotted, I use the rectangle command and you type rectangle. And then you give the coordinates of two vertices that are at diagonals to each other. So -1, -1, and 1, 1. So then we hit shift enter and we should get a picture. So we arrive at this picture that says it's the n equals 20,000 approximation of pi and it's 3.1406. And we can see those 20,000 random points and pi was computed by taking 4 times the fraction of points inside the circle. Now compared to what I showed earlier in the video, the colors are just inverted. So when I want my points to come out yellow after inverting the colors, I just do them as blue in Maxima. So for the truly adventurous out there, we'll wrap things up by showing how to animate this process point by point with an updated approximation of pi as each point is generated. And things start out pretty much the same as the code that we've already written. We have a counter that we want to set to 0. But now I'm going to have a list of labels showing the updated approximation of pi as each new point is generated. So I need to start with an empty list called label list. And I'm going to have a list of points, of course, and I call that point list. And I have a list of approximations of pi as each point gets added and the approximation is recomputed. This line that says FP print prec, that's floating point precision, I set to 5. And this didn't work that great because Maxima is still going to truncate trailing zeros on the approximations of pi. So you'll see the number for pi bounce around a little in the animation because of that. And I'm going to keep it fairly light by doing a 1000 point approximation of pi. So the original for loop looks very much like the one that we already did. I have a random x coordinate, a random y coordinate. I have a way of computing the distance between the origin and the point that was generated. I have a quick test to see whether or not that point is inside the circle. So that's if the distance to the origin is less than or equal to 1. And I'll increment the counter if it's inside the circle. And if not, we'll leave the counter alone. And we build the point list in the same way, appending the originally empty list with each point that's generated randomly. And we have our approximation of pi computed in the same way, taking 4 times the ratio of the number of points in the circle to the total number of points that's been generated so far. And then we have a list of approximations that we're appending as we go from 1 through m, where m is 1,000 in this case, to show these updated approximations. Now things get tricky in the next step because we have to make a nested for loop. And the issue there is that each frame of the animation has to show one more point than the frame before it. So we actually need a list in which each list element is a list of all the points generated at that moment. So that list is going to be called cumulative points. It's here as an empty list. I also need an extra list that I called temp list because I'm not going to use it for anything after this loop runs. And that starts as empty. So then I get into my nested loop. I have for n from 1 through m. Remember, m is the total number of points we're going to generate. That's 1,000 in this case. So n runs from 1 through 1,000. And for each of those n's that occurs from 1 to 1,000, I run this loop inside of it for k from 1 through n. So like if n is 10, then k is going to run from 1 through 10. And then when n is 11, k is going to run from 1 through 11 in the next iteration of the loop, and so on and so on. And what we're going to do here is take our temporary list, temp list, and append it with the kth element of point list. Now remember, point list was generated back in our original loop. That's just a list of all the points that are generated randomly from 1 through 1,000. So putting these brackets here and putting that k there means we're taking the kth element of point list. So what this inner loop has done is taken the first n elements of point list and turn that into a new list item in temp list. Then we're going to append that to cumulative points. So we're going to tack on that temp list to it. Again, temp list is now a list of the first n points that were generated. All right, so since that list of lists is a little bit confusing, what I want to do here is actually execute the code. So I hit shift enter on that first block of code. And then I'm going to hit shift enter on this nested loop section. And now this list called cumulative points, the first list element of it should have only the first point. The second list element should have the first 2 points. The third list element has the first 3 points, and so on. So let's just check it real quick. We can call out the first list element with brackets and one. So cumulative points, first list element. I hit shift enter and I see just the first randomly generated point. If I then replace that with a two, the second list element should have 2 points in it. And it does. So it's a list of ordered pairs, and there's two of them. And just to be really thorough here, I could do cumulative points of 3, and it has the first 3 points. So everything is working great. I'll just delete that real quick. And then we get into the actual animation of this thing. So again, we want to set a square aspect ratio. That's what the plot size part is about. And you can set the frame rate of the animation, which I just set to 20, which I think means 20 frames per second. But in the end, I would adjust it in my video editing software. And then I need a parameter that guides the animation, and that's what our list is. And I'm going to use the make list command to make a list of numbers from 1 through 1,000. So make list, make a list of all the i's as I goes from 1 through 1,000. That's just a list of numbers 1 through 1,000. The animate command is called with slider draw. You have to indicate the parameter for the animation, that's r, and the values that r is going to take, that's coming from our list. And then we have all the same stylistic things going on here, which is setting up the size of the graph, setting up the color and size of the points. And then what we're going to do is take the rth element of that list called cumulative points. Remember, that list has 1 point as its first list element. It has 2 points as its second list element, and so on and so on. So when we take the rth element of that list, that's going to build up these cumulative points in the graph. And then our labeling issues, again, we have to use concat in order to take this variable expression r and a prox list and turn them into text. So they'll work inside the label command. And it's going to say n is equal to r, again, as r goes from 1 through 1,000. So when n is 1, that's just the 1 point approximation, and then the 2 point approximation all the way to the 1,000 point approximation. And we're going to state the approximation of pi. And the approximation of pi is going to appear as a separate label that I located at a different ordered pair, just to keep things from bouncing around too much. And that approximation is going to come from a prox list. That's the list of successive approximations of pi. And finally, again, we want to have a clear picture of the square and the inscribed circle. So that's this last little bit. And it's good to do those last, because otherwise they just get kind of covered up with all the randomly generated points. Finally, we're going to execute the code and build this animation. And this takes a significant amount of time in Maxima. I mean, it takes several minutes. And as we go to larger and larger animations, the length it takes to process them actually grows non-linearly for reasons I don't understand. So if you wanted to make one of these that goes like all the way to 20,000 points, for example, it would be wise to break it up into chunks and then stitch them all together in your video editing software. So we're going to hit Shift Enter, and then I'll skip forward to the result. So our animation is ready, and it took about 5 minutes to render. And our first randomly generated point landed within the circle, giving us an approximation of pi of 4.0, which of course is not that great, but we're only using one point. We click on the animation to get it started, and we can see in our updated estimate of pi that these estimates are getting better and better as I generate more and more random points. So that's it on how to compute pi with random points. I hope you found this video useful for your own projects, and I hope I maybe piqued your interest in using wxMaxima as a computer algebra system. And I look forward to answering any questions you might have down in the comments section. Please check out the link to my math animations playlist, where you'll find many examples of short math animations, including the Maxima code given in the description, so you can try it out for yourself. Thanks for watching, and happy coding.